Welcome to the firm. It's SEBI all the way today with a little bit of Sahara thrown in. All schemes of arrangement will now be scrutinized by SEBI. The why and how of the complex new SEBI circular. And is SEBI unwilling or unable to seize Sahara assets? In India, schemes of arrangement are like Swiss knives. Companies have used them to do just about everything. Increase promoter shareholding, hide promoter liabilities, and even set off goodwill impairment against balance sheet reserves. Recently, minority investors have protested amalgamations by Escort, Siemens, India Bulls, the merger of Sesa Goa with Sterlite, a restructuring by Elecon Engineering, and in all of these cases, they've lost. Because the promoters' votes ensure the scheme goes through. Well, not anymore. A new SEBI circular issued this week puts in safeguards pertaining to valuation and voting and requires all schemes to be scrutinized by SEBI. But could this put SEBI in direct conflict with company law? Paiswini Upadhyay finds out.
In May last year, Escorts proposed a merger of its three subsidiaries with itself. A complicated cross-ownership amalgamation and merger proposal resulted in increase of promoters' voting control from 31% to 41%. The voting control of public shareholders fell proportionately when the proposal got the majority approval in the court. And why just Escorts? Concerns raised by minority shareholders and advisory firms in the restructuring by Elcon, amalgamation of Siemens Power Engineering with Siemens and India Bulls Power with India Bulls Infrastructure met with the same fate. These and many more schemes of arrangements have been ratified by courts under sections 391 to 394 of the Companies Act. But now, SEBI wants to scrutinize all schemes of arrangement before companies can approach the high courts. This week, the market regulator laid down new guidelines for listed companies that will require them to submit their schemes of arrangement to the exchanges. The exchanges will then submit the scheme to SEBI, which will examine them for adequate disclosures, convoluted structures and exaggerated valuations.
Sometimes objections are raised by public shareholders when the merger or the demerger is into an unlisted company which doesn't merge. I remember some time ago there was a lot of brouhaha in the papers about Wipro demerging a division and not listing that resulting company. I do not know if it eventually got listed, but at the time there was a lot of objection from public shareholders about that unlisted company not getting listed. Frequently there are objections to merger schemes which involve promoter liabilities being rolled into the listed company. That's a very convenient way for the promoter to borrow on the strength of the listed company's balance sheet. So, like I said earlier, what forms of abuse the merger and demerger provisions can be put to is bounded only by human imagination. But we all know there were abusive practices in this area.
Whenever a scheme comes up for final hearing, regional director, Department of Company Affairs and liquidator get some notice of the scheme. Let it make mandatory to issue notice to SEBI also. So the scrutiny which SEBI is going to do of each and every scheme, let them do the scrutiny and come up to the High Court. And if they have serious objections, let that objection be made to the court itself. So court will once and for all decide whether the objections raised by SEBI, stock exchanges, or the company or the shareholders are valid and should be whether there is a need to modify the scheme.
The scheme of arrangements so far were being done directly without SEBI's intervention. Stock exchange were directly giving approval to the companies, and there were certain instances where the new companies were getting created by virtue of the schemes of arrangement which were approaching SEBI directly for listing without using the IPO route by virtue of the provisions available under the Companies Act and under the SEBI regulations. By this new circulars, the SEBI would be having advantage to review all such companies in advance, and they would be able to control any new entry into the market where the minority interests are not protected.
minority interest that seems to be the overriding concern of SEBI, which is why the new guidelines provide for an independent valuation by the exchanges and SEBI. Companies will have to first get their schemes vetted by an independent chartered accountant. The audit committee will be required to place this before the board and then submit it to the exchange. The exchange will then forward the scheme to SEBI, and simultaneously both the exchange and SEBI will examine the scheme and issue observation letters. And it's not for nothing that SEBI wants to scrutinize schemes for fair valuation. Take for instance the AkzoNobel amalgamation last year with its three unlisted group entities. At that time, proxy advisory firm Ingevern had raised concerns on grounds of lack of financials of unlisted entities, nebulous valuations presented to investors, one-off write-offs and unsecured loans. 23% of the company's public shareholders opposed the proposal for these very reasons. But a majority vote of 76% sailed it through.
I think what SEBI is now trying to do is to let the High Court have the benefit of a specialist scrutiny on the scheme. So what SEBI is saying in this circular is that every merger involving a listed company will now have to present to the High Court all the comments that the stock exchanges and SEBI provide on the scheme.
After having three scrutiny, independent chartered accountant, fairness opinion, then audit committee report, and thereafter also I need to go into stock exchange, I need to go to SEBI and explain them, justify my valuations, what for? Where is the end? In fact, Payaswini, I must say this with respect, Supreme Court, time and again, not only Supreme Court, across the board, all high courts, all Supreme Court decisions, if you see, starting from the historical decision and latest being the celebrated judgment being the Tomko Lever, Supreme Court has said, we will not go into the merits of the valuation. We are not equipped to do so. We will just not go. We will leave this valuation business in the realm of a commercial decision of the shareholders. So let the shareholders decide. Not in one case where Supreme Court has applied its mind or gone into the merits and demerits of the valuations. So even if SEBI tomorrow comes up with a valuation and recommends something to the High Court, the courts are not going to go interfere in their valuation.
And that would be the true test of this new framework. The consideration that courts give to SEBI's observations, without which this entire effort would be futile. If history is anything to go by, SEBI has had little luck on that front. In 2002, the Bombay High Court ratified a reduction of capital scheme of Sterlite despite the regulator's intervention and argument that the scheme forces the minority out of the company. The court ruled that SEBI had no power to challenge the scheme of arrangement. Perhaps this could be the reason why SEBI, in its new framework, has added a voting requirement that could very well stall schemes.
As per the new guidelines, any scheme of arrangement by a listed company would be approved only if the number of public shareholders voting in favor of the resolution is twice the number opposing it. This when the Companies Act requires only a numerical majority of shareholders represented by 75% in value of the shares. Question is, can SEBI impose an additional voting condition for listed companies for schemes of arrangement when none was envisaged by the Parliament under the Companies Act?
After the scheme has been sanctioned and passed, one has to look at the shareholding pattern, voting pattern. From the public shareholders, we'll have to find out how many have voted against. And you will need to have twice the number of amongst the public shareholders who have voted in favor of the scheme. So which means what are you doing is you are saying that ignore the majority and ignore everything, everyone who has sanctioned the scheme, who have approved the scheme. Now let's go to these public shareholders and find out whether they are in agreement or not. So what are you doing? You are converting minority into a majority decision. You are subjecting the majority decision, you are subjecting the statutory requirement of the Companies Act, and you are saying that now this statutory approval is subject to this verification. Now, is this something which is permissible?
In other areas like, say, the buyback of securities, now that's another area where the Companies Act has a robust framework and SEBI's regulations will supplement that framework. The respect in which the jurisprudence on buyback differs from the circular is that the provisions relating to mergers don't give SEBI any power to notify any regulations to supplement that framework. Whereas most of these other areas where SEBI has supplemented the Companies Act, it would derive its power to do that from the Companies Act itself.
Most lawyers I spoke to conceded that there has been considerable abuse of schemes of arrangement by promoters to the detriment of minority shareholders. And so, it's no one's case that SEBI should not protect the interest of the minority. The additional concern, besides the ones raised by experts in this story, is that the circular does not distinguish mergers that have a potential of abuse from the ones that don't. For instance, as one lawyer mentioned, merger of a wholly owned subsidiary into the parent listed company, which has little or no effect on public shareholders. Secondly, if companies go ahead with their schemes without meeting the new voting requirements, can and will SEBI take punitive action against them? Experts told me to wait for the jurisprudence to evolve on this. But lastly, and perhaps most importantly, the success of this brave attempt by SEBI will depend on how much importance courts give to SEBI's opinion. In Mumbai, Paisani Upadhyay. Alright, so the next scheme that takes place will have to abide by this circular and it will be a test case. We'll be watching. But right now, let's take a quick break. On the other side, we ask, is SEBI unwilling or unable to seize Sahara assets?